sometimes just showing up is the right thing to do. I had a dream last night where I got into a big conflict with a boss-like figure. It got really chewed out badly, and I was woke up, and I've been at odds all day with feeling very, very out of sorts, trying to figure out what in the world was that all about. And I believe I figured it out where I started going back into graphics, trying to produce some video based on graphics. And I believe that's probably what I was being warned about and being chewed out. It says, no, that's not it. You don't want to do that. So I stop and just showing up here now, even though I don't feel so inspired. You know, even if we don't feel inspired, sometimes showing up is very, very helpful. Hopefully, I don't have that episode of that deer again that scared the heck out of me last night. I walked into a store today, and someone was talking to someone else there about deer hunting and deers. And I said, hey, I had a deer in my front yard. And then they proceeded to tell me all about the situation with deers, what's going on with them right now, why they were there, why the deer bolted, all this kind of stuff. They're very knowledgeable. So they filled me in and explained exactly what happened. Amazing, huh? You just run into the people like this. Today is is White Cane Day. White Cane Day is Site Conservation Day. So today is, I know we cannot read this because it's, but there's a little cane here. And it is Site Conservation today. And I got a little, you can't see it. A little white cane with a red bottom onto it and a White Cane Day thing. And site conservation. I should have said, you know, I'm trying to help the spiritually blind. My whole life I've tried to help the spiritually blind, help them see. And that's an even bigger issue than physical sight. The spiritual blindness is what we all suffer from. Spiritual blindness, and we still suffer from it, and it's terrible. And we know that some have regained their spiritual sight, and yet we remain in darkness. And I can explain why we're in darkness, but what I can't explain is why we haven't been able to regain our spiritual sight. I cannot explain the timing of it. It's mysterious, to say the least. We don't want to remain blind, and yet we do. And yet we do. How astonishing is this? I turned the television on to watch a baseball game, and actually the game wasn't on, and so they just had some program, sports program or something. But just the whole feel of the thing, the commercials, the music, everything, it was just terrible. I just felt like, this is just so horrible. This world is so horrible. Pun intended. Because most of the content on there were actresses. The commercials, the voiceovers, the ones doing the interviewing, the ones involved. And it's just so horrible. So absolutely horrible. I can't believe how awful this world has become, and probably has always been, really. And you know, we have to say, if somebody wants outcomes, then let them pursue the outcomes. We cannot allow ourselves to be used to pursue outcomes for somebody else. Someone who wants outcomes, and we're just supposed to be used to produce outcomes for someone who's addicted to the belief in outcomes. If they want outcomes, let them pursue their own outcomes. It has to be that way. As Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead. I'm tired of trying to provide outcomes. You know, the reality, the whole purpose of the spiritual path is to accept no outcomes. There are no outcomes whatsoever. And yet there's these so many spirits here in this world that expect you to, you know, work to provide outcomes for them. It's crazy. Well, if someone is crazy enough to want to try to change reality, then let them be the ones that try to change reality. I don't want to have any part in that. And they may say, well, I'm not going to get the outcome I want. Well, of course, if you're trying to change reality, you're not going to get the outcome you want, because you can't. You can't change reality. You can't change the fact that absolute freedom, which is what we are, cannot experience outcomes. There's no such thing as experiencing outcomes. And this helps get us into this video. Experiencing outcomes. No such thing as experiencing outcomes. We're not experiencing outcomes right now. Not at all. We're kind of just experiencing nothing at all. Which is why the world seems flat. There's no real depth to it, because we're trying to experience what doesn't exist. That's not any experience, is it? We're sort of experiencing a lack of experiencing. But the feeling we need to experience is a feeling of no outcomes, which you would say is bliss. Peace of mind and bliss, no outcomes. Now it's possible that we can experience this. I feel it's possible for me. If God willing, I guess. I mean, no, it's me, you know, me willing, I guess. God's always willing. We have to be willing. It's difficult to, you know, say exactly. It's sort of just an overall contextual continuity fear issue, isn't it? Continuity fear is a very generalized fear. You might call it free-floating fear. Very much a free-floating anxiety, continuity fear. And, you know, the psychiatrists, psychoanalytic folks, you know, they always try to trace fear down to some sort of concrete event, some existential, you know, some outcome was frustrated for us. That's not what free-floating anxiety is about. The continuity fear is a fear of, you know, experiencing no outcomes. And then the psychoanalytic theory says, well, the ego's healthy because it guides us away from that, towards outcomes and towards working, building a strong ego. It's crazy. It's absolutely upside down and backwards. So this amorphous, free-floating anxiety is continuity fear. And you cannot treat continuity fear with psychoanalysis, with psychotherapy. Doesn't work. I realized that. I tried everything, and nothing worked. And then I came across A Course in Miracles. I said, this is going to work, and it has. I knew that this is what I have to do. Not all these different therapies and this and this and this and this and this to treat, you know, severe free-floating anxiety. And there's so many of us have that. You have to take the spiritual path, which is a path of what? Practicing. It's a path of practicing. Getting familiar with practicing, with our practicing. And then we get familiar with more practicing, and more and more, and better and better and better and better and better. That's the spiritual path. This is the only way to treat free-floating anxiety, which is really continuity fear, which is the fear of ending our pretense that we're different than what we really are, that we're somehow experiencing concretization and outcomes. We're not. We're not experiencing that. So we feel, if we're not pretending, that we won't be doing anything, we'll cease to exist. No, if we stop pretending, we'll be experiencing reality is what we'll be doing. See, we confuse doing with experiencing. We think that if we're not doing something, meaning pretending that we're something other than what we are, if we're not doing something, meaning pursuing outcomes, that we won't be doing anything. Well, that's true. Basically, you say, but we'll be experiencing reality. It's not a doing, it's an experiencing. Doing has to do with outcomes. So we're all freaked out saying, yeah, whatever. I won't know what to do. I won't know what to do. Meaning, I won't know how to pursue outcomes. I don't need to pursue outcomes because there isn't any such thing. So all I need is just to experience reality. Just experience abidance. Now, in that abidance, there's functioning, but it's not doing. There's relating. There's existing in some way. There's communicating. But there's no doing. There's no outcome. It's seen that there's no outcome. Now this seems very abstract. No outcome. Well, this is what we have to experience. Because we're perfect. Everyone's perfectly free. How can there be outcomes taking place? There are no outcomes taking place. In all the dance of consciousness, humans just being part of the dance of consciousness, it's all one dance. Animals, plants, insects, elements, all of this dream is just one dance of dreaming, which we call consciousness, which is really just dreaming. Outcome consciousness, you might call it. That's not true consciousness. It is consciousness still, but it's not what we would call pure consciousness. Or it's all the same consciousness, however. It's like the Trimurti, the Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva. That's all. We say consciousness, well, it's just dreaming. It's imagining. It's pretending. It's pretending. And Parabrahma, or Purna Brahma Narayana, or the God the Father, which we say in Western traditions, God the Father, that's reality. That's reality. So is God the Son, so is God the Holy Spirit. That's a little different than the Trimurti of like Hinduism. It's different. Brahma would be the creator, Vishnu is the sustainer, and Shiva is the destroyer, something like that. In the Western tradition, the Trinity is God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. That doesn't have to do with imagining, sustaining the imagining, and then destroying. It's not the same. We would say that Parabrahma, or the true Creator God, has three aspects of being the originator. Then the extension of this is God the Spirit. And then the blessing upon God the Spirit, because is the Holy Spirit, because God the Spirit tried to change what it was, and so a blessing was deemed appropriate by God the Father, Prime Creator. So there's Prime Creator and Prime Created, and a blessing upon the Prime Created. That is not the same as the Trimurti in Hinduism, which is talking about the universe, Brahma the Creator of the universe, Shiva Vishnu the Sustainer, and Shiva as the destroyer, bringing it about. What Jesus would say is that's all just a dream. That's the pretending. The Trimurti is about the pretending. And this came to mind as I've seen all these Maseratis around now. Maserati, Mas fire. Fire of a goddess. It's a Trimurti, it's a trident. And we've had two instances of planes relating to Malaysian Airlines with the trident on the trident as a trident. Well, that God the Father, Brahma, creator of this universe, which is a belief in outcomes, sustainer, Vishnu. What's the third incident? Shiva the destroyer, and Maserati is the mother's goddess. Arati means fire. Purification by fire, fire burning, destruction by fire. pretty interesting. I never know where I'm going to go with, you know, the mind is just free, it's just open. So I don't have any preconceived notion of what's going to be said next. This works out for the best, actually. Sorry for all the kids in the world being born into this world. Of course, it's their choice. And so, you know, you can't feel guilty about it or anything like that. They chose to come here. Everyone chooses to come here. They came here because they feel that this is what they wanted. But, I mean, the brainwashing that and the manipulation that's being laid upon them is just astonishing. And I noticed that television was so fear-based. So, it always has been, right? The announcers and their, you know, And all the dramas and the actresses and actors are always kind of in this breathless, fearful state, this tense, you know, dramatic, like, it's dangerous, you know, this is, Lord, it's like, oh, I'm scared, you know, and the music in the background, you know, the soundtrack is all very staccato and, you know, you're like generating fear, like that buck out last night, you know, like some big monster thumping around right near you, you know, Godzilla's like, boom, 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 stuff's being destroyed. The whole soundtrack, I'm very sensitive to music and sound, and it's so fear-based, it's just an abomination, what they're doing. Absolute abomination. You know, that's the best you can say about it, it's an absolute abomination. So now let's bring this around to something positive. Just not hearing any soundtrack at all is actually very, very welcoming and refreshing to get away from that. Just to find out you can be in silence and you're okay. And this brings us back to the fear of not doing, of not pursuing outcomes. We think if we're not, we will not know what to do. Well, we don't need to worry about what to do because we're experiencing, abiding. And from that abidance, we function. But we don't need to do anything in terms of generating some outcome. That doesn't mean we're not functioning, that people, you know, still eat food and, you know, work, whatever. But it's not seen as a doing, because it's just a continual abidance of experiencing. And so we keep track of all these doings and outcomes. We think we're finding grievances, stuff happening, all this stuff. And none of it is an outcome. We're all still perfectly free. So no outcome has ever happened. No outcome has ever taken place. It's impossible. No situation, no circumstance, no outcome. None of it has taken place. Did I just hear the clomp of a hoof on the street there? Maybe. I didn't bring a flashlight out with me. Should have. Maybe I can just ring the bell, you know. the bowl, ring the bowl, that'll get the deer to go away. Hey. Or let the deer hang out, I don't care. They're not dangerous to humans, they just want to get away from them. So doing and experiencing the difference, doing and experiencing the difference, doing and experiencing. We're afraid. If we won't know what to do, we'll go crazy. But we can just simply abide in experiencing freedom. That is right now. It always is present. And we will not then have a life that people think they have a life by because they add up all their doing. So if I did this and I did this and then back then this year I did that. And so they think, well, I had a life. The only problem is when you think you have a life, you'll end up having another one. This is true. The price you pay for believing you had a life is that you get another one. Until finally you realize that you never ever had a life. No one's ever had a life at all. Thank God. Because that would, you know, be an outcome. So eventually we realize that no, I've never had any outcomes. I've never had any life. I'm eternal life. I'm not a life. I'm eternal life. All is eternal life. There are no lives. There's just the one eternal lifeness, the one eternal lifeness. Changed my golf setup today. What's in my bag? Changed it. Especially the golf ball. Changed it all. And I decided I'm going to emphasize just around the green, the short game. I'm going to try and do that. We'll see how it goes. I've never actually stuck with that, you know, and I'm going back to a high spin ball, soft high spin, which is great around the greens. Just great. And this is where most shots are, around the green. And I'm going to give it a try. Maybe lose a little distance. Who cares? Just hit it up there near the pin and rely on your short game. And this is an interesting tactic I'm going to try out. I think if you want to score, this is the way you have to go. And just use one ball, get used to it, and stick with it, and you learn exactly the characteristics of it. Don't just be jumping around from this ball to another ball to another ball. This is one of the big secrets. Two secrets is the short, just short game and the ball you're using, and make sure you use a ball that's really, really soft and spins a lot, and you can control it around the green, and use the same ball all the time so you get used to it. This is like the best pro advice possible, actually, if you want to start scoring, ultimately. But it's amazing. I mean, looking back, how stupid have I been? You know, and then looking at people now, the younger, who are commenting on golf forums, I just, like, you know, I can't take it, because it's just, I realized that was me back then. This is what I was used to be like. I just didn't get it. Most people never get it. They never really get it with golf. It's amazing how golf blinds us. It's amazing how the world blinds us, and it's just extraordinary. Everybody's working on everything but what they need to do, actually, in golf. Just now I look back and I'm seeing it. I want to say, hey, golfers, you know, you're wasting your time. Don't waste your whole life like I have. Talking about, they you know, they're so insecure, golfers, that they love to brag about all these tech, you know, they talk about all these technical stuff, which has nothing to do with it. I mean, they focus on all this, what the pros do, you know, how much their approach shots, you know, how much spin can they get on the ball, how can they draw it back, you know, and stuff like this, and this is ridiculous. They focus on stuff that's ridiculous. They keep trying to play like pros, thinking, and instead of just playing smart. They want to be able to hit wedge shots and have the ball suck back, you know, 10 feet. You know, oftentimes that actually puts you in a worse position. You see, the pros, they'd spin it too much. It's a big problem. What you want is you want distance control, and the ball is where you just stop where you hit it, just kind of take one hop and stop. Which is easy to do. You don't need to worry about all this stuff. Oh, I gotta stop my ball or something. That's ridiculous. So they spend their time and lives, and they just don't get it. Amazing. Even when people tell them, they don't get it. And I know I've been there and done that. And everybody's just the same. It's the same. It's the same. Same with the spiritual path. We just don't get it. And at some point, we get smart about it. And you say, why in the heck didn't I just do that before? It's so easy. What in the world? Just a neither nor. Practice. Simple. I'm neither judging the world, nor I neither judge the world, nor do I not judge it. It's just take a neutral position towards the dream. I neither accept the dream, nor do I reject the dream. And just let it be there in this neutral expression. That's both positive and negative. See, this is the greatness of this practice. We're so used to saying positive outcomes, negative outcomes, right? So we can't hardly imagine ourselves without outcomes. It terrifies us. So how can we abide in no outcomes? It's just experiencing. We have this terrible continuity fear. Well, we have to practice, of course. And so we make a positive statement, well, a negative statement. I neither accept it. I neither accept the dream. So you're saying, I neither accept it, nor do I not accept it. And that's a positive. But we use an overall negative form, neither nor, because we are, ultimately, we are saying, I don't want this anymore. So this is the right emphasis. And yet, we're within that context, we're making a negative and a positive statement. Like, okay, I don't see any outcome here. No, I neither see an outcome, nor do I not see an outcome. And it's a neutral, overall neutral statement. But we have this, still this form of outcomes, this form of pursuing outcomes, although we're stating that there's no outcome there really to pursue. See, neither nor. There's neither an outcome, nor is there not an outcome. What is that? That's ultimately not an outcome, right? It's a zero. But we're putting it in a format as it implies that there potential, at least it reminds us, you know, it makes us sort of like a security blanket. So we keep this security blanket. We don't throw everything away, we keep a security blanket. Now, if we only would have known of this practice before, you see, well, better late than never. It's just like the golfer, you know, obsessing about, well, what's the launch angle, you know, how many degrees of launch angle, what's exact, my shot shape and the launch angle and you know, the carry and you know, they just think that there have to be some kind of super pros, you know. No, just get up there and bash it, and then bash it again and get it up by near the pin. That's it. And then that your short game take over. That's really what you got to do. Just wail on it, you know, just get up there and just wail on it and get it down the fairway. And then wail on it again and get it up as close as you can to the pin. Just look at the pin, look at the pin, look at the pin, look at the pin. Keep aiming for it, aiming for it, aiming for it, aiming for it. I'm gonna go right at it. None of that stupid stuff. You sit there, okay, how many yards? Well, I want to hit a fade in there and the center of the green, and I want to, you know, position myself there, you know, and I want to roll out, blah, 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 blah. You know, I want to hit a high or a low, you know, cut shot. That's nonsense. Absolute nonsense. Look at the pin as you're setting up. Just keep looking at it, right at it, right? Just say, I'm going to hit that pin with this shot. I'm going to hit it. And just go right at it. Just go right at it and try to knock the flag down. Every time. This completely simplifies the game. And you know what? A lot of times you actually get very close. And other times you might, if you go a little far, a little short, whatever, a little right, then let your short game take over. Just chip it. You know, if you try to aim right at the flag and hit right there, you'll find you get close to it. Whereas you start doing all this other stuff, fooling around with all this, you know, thinking. The game will still be terrible. Me, I just hit it dead straight. I don't have any. I'm not thinking about anything. I just hit it like on a line dead straight right at the flag. And, you know, well, then, oh, gee, it's 2 feet away. How about that? Oh, well, but a little far or something. Oh, okay, well, still like 15 feet away. How about that? Just get it up there by the flag. Simple. Bash it. Hit it, knock the flag down. And get it in the hole. That's it. Don't think about anything else. And it really is just that simple. But there's nothing that people obsess about more than golf. The magazines, you know, these people, I mean, it's just like endless tips by the pros. Endless tips. The worst thing you can do is read those golf magazines. I think, you know, Jack Nicklaus screwed my golf game up more than anybody growing up. All lesson T, you know, he's in all the golf magazines. And you think, oh, if Jack Nicklaus says do this, you got to do it. And he's, you know, thinking your way around the course, this shot, how do I do shape this shot, how am I, and he's given us, you know, how he views golf, but he's a complete freak. He was an absolute freak of nature, you know, a mental freak, and you can't play golf like Jack Nicklaus, and if you try, you're going to spend your lifetime in misery. He's always thinking, analyzing, checking every situation. This is someone who's a perfectionist trying to be the greatest golfer ever lived. You know, that's not us. Okay, that's not us. It's like a spiritual path. You know, we're not trying to be Ramana Maharshi, like just, you know, lightened at 16 or 17 and just poof, like that, you know. This is ridiculous. He had already been enlightened in a previous life, most likely, right? Ananda Maima had never fallen into pretending ever. So never even had any life here before. That's called an avatar or an avatara. Never had entered into pretense, trying to change what spirit is at all. So born enlightened, completely enlightened. That's not us. So we got to simplify. My God, wasted my life trying to, you know, so I need to, Jack Nicklaus knows how to play golf. Great, the best. So if I want to be the best, I've got to learn to play golf like him. Well, I'm not trying to be the best, right, you know, anymore. Well, how about just being good? You know, how about just being good? So for us, you know, the intermediate step of just abidance in experiencing. Abidance in experiencing. We'll be close, you know, close like Ramana Maharshi. Close to it. we may not have the same, you know, greatness of potency of that abidance as he had, flawless, perfect abidance, but we'll be very close, you know. I mean, if I just start, just play golf the way I can play golf, you know, then, you know, maybe I could play golf, play around with Jack Nicklaus. Well, of course, he's just late 70s, so maybe I could. but can't hit it, can't play like he used to anymore. But those people are like, they overanalyze everything, and it ruins it for us. They're mental freaks. And you know, someone like, you know, the Buddha, for instance, is this great spiritual wisdom, giving out all this stuff, you know. No, we need to simplify it. Just a couple of practices, that's it. Just like golf, just wail on the ball off the tee. I'm just going to wail on it. Just get it down there as far as possible. And then the second shot, just go right at the flag. Just dead on, okay, and just let it go. And that's it. It almost sounds so simple, it sounds like cheating, but it's not. It's not, there's nothing. You know, the problem is these great golfers, you know, just pass down this tradition of golf, and we feel like a golfer, like somehow we're on, you know, it's a privilege for us to be playing the golf, and that we have to do it the right way, the way that these great golfers have, you know, taught and played, and that we're supposed to do it this way. This is the insanity of it, and it holds everyone back. You know, the young people think they got to play like Tiger Woods, and now the next crop of people got to play like Jordan Spieth. You got to putt like Jordan Spieth. Got to do a forward press on your putter. You know, do all this kind of stuff, because they say, well, that's how you're supposed to play golf, which is utter nonsense. We don't have to be as brilliant as Gautama Buddha in or like a Longchenpa, knowing every single type of practice. I mean, no, that's absurd for us. Just like golf, I don't have to be thinking like Jack Nicklaus, analyzing everything. He's got the eagle eyes, and he's just completely seeing it. Okay, the slope of the fairway, you know, how it runs out. I wanted to go this place to there, and da 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 da, and then setting up the next shot. You know, just get up there and just pipe it, you know, just absolutely, you know, wail on it and get it out there, and then just gun it at the flag, and there aren't any more thoughts needed at all. So in other words, for abidance, we only need a few practices. Very simple. We're not trying to compete with, you know, Jack Nicklaus or Gautama Buddha or anyone else. We're just trying to you know, reach abidance, just accept abidance. That's it. And then let the chips fall where they may. I don't know. Maybe I'll start, you know, tearing up the golf course or something, but, you know, I don't know. And the problem is when you get with these golfers who, you know, are analyzing everything, and they meticulous of thinking everything through, and what do I want to hit at, like three quarters low shot, skipping in there, and da 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 da. You think, oh, I need to play like that. What am I doing? You know, I was playing a golfer like that. It's really good. And so I step up the tee, but I just kept playing the way I wanted to play. And, you know, I hit this shot, and it's like stops like 18 inches from the hole, and he just goes, whoa, you know, wow. And he came unglued after that, you know. And then the next hole, I gunned it right at the pin, another close one, and the next one, close one. And I just kept, you know, knocking down the pin. And then he told me, hey, don't change what you're doing, man. It's working great. Good advice, right? on the tee, just grip it and rip it. And on spiritual practice, you know, just practice. You know, I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Have a practice. You can just go into it and just wail on it. I'm neither succeeding nor am I not succeeding. I'm neither understanding nor am I not understanding. Or you can do the both. I'm both understanding and not understanding. I'm absolutely both understanding and not understanding. So here we just have a few core practices that we use here. You know, there's a nice grab bag, but there, you know, not so many. We can, you know, we can narrow them down. The key is just do them. You don't get up there on the tee, like in golf, and like pick some grass up and throw it like all, you see all the pros, you know. And, oh yeah, I got to test the wind. I'd say the wind's going. It's about a left to right, you know, slightly downwind. That's about 10 miles an hour. Maybe it's swirling down, up elevated, so it's swirling a little bit. The landing area looks like it might be a little bit soft out there, you know, and I don't want to push it too much, and I got to compensate for the wind here, and I want to hit a power fade, and I want to ride the wind, but if I ride it too much, I might reach that bunker out there. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to you know, start out a little further, or, you know, maybe I should go to the 3-wood, and da 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 da. And you know, this is why we have are taught to do it. Like, take all the elements into account. You know, everything that's going on. You have to be aware. Everything that could be influencing, you must factor it in. So you're doing all this calculus in your head. You know, now just tee the ball up, take your stance, look. Just look where you want the ball to go, just like there's a flag out there. So I'm going to hit that flag. Imagine there's a flag in the fairway. Just plant a flag. Say, where do I want the ball to stay? Plant a flag there, okay? Then nothing else matters. You see, oh, there's a flag. I'm gonna knock that flag down with this shot. Tee the ball up, okay? Just do your thing and just wail on it. And that's it. And 99 times out of 100, that's far better than doing all this calculus, okay? And if there's some calculus that needs to be done, you know, there's some super heavy wind and all this stuff's going, well, then if you have to do a little calculus there, you can do it. And you probably will screw up anyway. It's probably better just to grip it and rip it anyway. So just imagine that flag planted in the fairway, same as spiritual practice. You know, it's just like the simple aim, neither nor practice. We're just going to do neither nor practice. And just do it. In other words, we're going to practice in a way that gets us close to abidance. And we're probably not going to hold out the shot, but we're going to get close to abidance. We're going to get close to it. And we do. We absolutely do. There's various forms we can use of the practicing. Like, agree with your adversary practice. I mean, that's fun. If you feel like it's fun, you like doing that, then do it. Yes, I'm absolutely perfectly terrible. Absolutely, I'm terrible. I'm absolutely perfectly terrible. Yes, I'm absolutely perfectly wrong. Absolutely perfectly mistaken. I am that one who's absolutely perfectly mistaken. And then we go, neither nor. I'm neither absolutely perfectly mistaken, nor am I not absolutely perfectly mistaken. And get familiar with this. Again, we said, the continuity fear is a fear of what do I do? What do I do? I don't see any outcomes. I can't, where are my outcomes? Where's myself? Where's my outcome self that I've built up, you know? And so we say, oh yeah, I neither have an outcome self, nor do I not have an outcome self. I neither have an outcome self, nor do I not have an outcome self. So we're both using, you know, the negative and the affirmative in terms of doing and outcomes, but by putting it together as one coin, one statement, it's really, there's no outcome there, right? But, and yet we're going through the motions, so to speak. which reassures us. We're going through the motions, the verbal, conceptual, belief, motions of I both have no outcome. I neither have an outcome, nor do I not have an outcome. I neither have a self, nor do I not have a self. I neither have an outcome self, nor do I not have an outcome self. I neither have an outcome self, nor do I not have an outcome self. And the funny thing is, like in golf, if you think you're not taking any for everything into account, you think that you're, that means that you're a lousy golfer and aren't going to do well. And really, it's just the opposite. The more you try to think, the worse you get. We think, well, I need to do what the pros do. And okay, let me see now. and they're thinking, looking, and paralysis through analysis. Often, like they have that 150-yard marker stake in the middle of the fairway, which is very helpful. Just try to hit it. Just try to hit it with your shot. That's all. Just go after it and hit it. Don't think about anything else. Well, I need to dogleg this way. I need to do this. And you know, the pros, they hit it so far, they're so extraordinary, that they do need to think about the consequences of all that power. You know, we don't have that power. We're not going to, you know, hit our tee shot 350 through the fairway. You know, they're thinking, okay, I got to shape the shot because, it's going to, go 350, and if I hit it 350, it's going to go through the fairway, so I got to make sure I put it, draw it around here. Well, yeah, I mean, they have to deal with their own power, problems that their power gives them. We don't have that problem. So we say, well, I'm going to hit it, 250, right in the middle, hit the stake out there. I don't have to think about anything else. So, it's easy for us. Just a couple practices. And then a little tweaking around the green. You know, we get close to abundance, then we do a little tweaking. And it's just like that. And the weird thing is, if you do that in golf, you think you're not really playing golf. You say, well, yeah, I scored well, but I didn't really play golf. I wasn't really playing golf. I mean, it was easy for me, didn't have any troubles, but that's not golf. You know, I didn't struggle. I don't struggle, but golf, you're supposed to struggle. You're supposed to be intimidated. You're supposed to be overwhelmed be sitting up there talking with your caddy saying, wow, so it's 114, to the front, and I wanted to land at about 117, and I wanted to roll out a little bit, so I want to bring it in, a little bit low, and then there's a little swale there. I want to see if I can hit that ridge, and they go on and on and on and on and on and on. A little bit of wind, so the wind's taking some off of it. I want to put a little extra on it, and on and on. No, you see, we think, well, that's cool. If we don't do that, we think, well, I don't know what I'm doing. I'm not playing golf. So if we don't obsess about all the spiritual stuff, we think, well, I'm not really, spiritual. I'm not really on the spiritual path. I'm just doing these exercises. Real simple. It's easy. I can do it. Sure, it's effective, but I mean, that's not really, I'm not really being spiritual. I want to be on the spiritual path. I want to, all this difficulty. All this failure. I need this failure and difficulty, and I want to think like I am, following in the footsteps of the, the great ones. I try to play like Jack Nicklaus. I say, yeah, well, at least I got the swing down. Jack told me to swing this well. I got the hip turn. I got this, the elbow, everything. Yeah, I'm swinging it like Jack Nicklaus. And, well, where was the ball going? It's going out of bounds. It's going out of bounds. I said, well, at least I got the swing down. If I got the swing down, why is it going out of bounds? So spiritually, people are saying, yeah, I'm doing my yoga, I'm doing my breathing, I'm doing this, I'm about my life. But I'm dying. But at least I got the right posture, you know. And but if you do it right, it almost feels like you're cheating, you know, really. Like, I found a way to swing that works so well. It's like cheating, you know. It's like, wow, I could just swing like this my whole life, but no, nobody ever said to swing like that. So, you know, you can't swing like that. Bound to have bad results. Actually not. So the experts, you know, come in and say, no, you can't do that. That'll be, you know, you're going to pull hook that one out of bounds. Can't, don't. Yes, no, actually not. It's I mean, if you just follow the simple advice, for instance, like just thinking about golf, everything's simplified. Not even have to think about it. Oh, I'm going to a golf course. No, not really. Yeah, superficially. But what am I doing? I'm just hitting to imaginary flag there, and then hitting the flag on the green, and knocking the ball in the hole. That's it. Not doing anything else. It's like, yeah, that's like defeating the world, right? It's being a world beater. Like, yeah, we're supposed to be world beaters. There's a thing, we think the world's supposed to beat us, beat us up. No, we don't. Not supposed to beat us up. We just think so. But really, I mean, if we practice properly, you know, we'll get free of our continuity fear pretty quickly. If anyone actually ever, you know, does this. Because we're honoring, you know, using both the negative and positive terms of talking about outcomes and doing. Well, I did this, or I didn't do that. You know, oh, yeah, I did this, but you know, I didn't do that. Oh, I got this outcome, I didn't get this outcome here. Okay, oh, yeah, I'm neither doing this nor am I not doing it. I'm neither doing it nor not doing it. So we keep the general form, and yet it's still in like a zero outcome stands, yeah, it doesn't interfere with our abidance. When someone says, "Oh, are you a good golfer?" They think, "Well, can you do all this fancy stuff?" You know, I don't know. Is that a good golfer, or just can you just, you know, handle the golf course easily and not even be bothered by it? It depends what you're looking for. The good golfer, they all these different shot shapes, and of course they have to practice and play every single day to keep that up. The pros play almost virtually every single day. They might have one travel day Monday. You know, they often travel Monday, then start again Tuesday, 6 days a week. They're practicing every fast, and then playing, and then they just never stop. Well, you know, if you do that, you're going to maybe, you know, maybe get bored. You say, well, I want to just fool around with something else, you know, something shots this way or that way, but I don't really need to. But yeah, are you a good golfer? So, are you really good on the spiritual path? Or are you just doing these simple exercises? That's it. Well, it doesn't show much there, you know. Well, who cares? Who cares how good you are on the path? Isn't the idea, you know, to finish on the spiritual path? I mean, abidance, isn't abidance the goal? So who cares if you get there easily and quickly? I mean, that's just smart. I don't think I've ever played with any golfer or seen anybody who plays this way. They're trying to do too much out there. Less is more. Less is more. Same with the spiritual path. Less is more. I mean, look at all these people with their libraries. They have these thousands of spiritual books. Are they in abidance? Are they abiding? In experiencing? No. They say, well, you know, how can I? I mean, I got to think about all this stuff and get, you know, all these books. I got to figure it all out. There's nothing to figure out. We have just continuity fear. That's it. We try to change what we are. We try to pretending that we're something different. We're trying to reach outcomes, which would be changing what we are. And we just need to realize that we can't do it. And actually, the outcomes have never happened. Nothing has ever happened. You don't need a book for that. You need to practice. You don't need a golf instruction book. You just say, there's a flag, hit the ball at the flag. There's another flag, hit the ball at that flag. And pretty soon you figure, okay, how can I do that? I mean, you figure out a way to hit the ball at the flag. and then roll the ball, you know, roll, you putt the ball. You can figure out a way pretty easily to putt the ball at the hole. That's it. And then, you know, the other aspect of, you know, chipping or whatever. But you just figure it out and then do it this way, that works. But the golfers are thinking about a million things. And then worrying about all the stuff they're not thinking about. They're up on the tee and they're worried about what they're not thinking about. Oh my God, I must have forgotten like a whole bunch of tips. What are those tips again? Like, okay, I didn't go through my checklist, you know. So now what would Jack Nicklaus or Tiger Woods, when he was up there on the tee, now what are they thinking about? Okay, you know, I'm sure that I'm missing a lot of stuff here. I feel stupid. So, and then they're already defeated. You're already defeated. Say, well, I don't think I'm very good here. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to hit a bad shot. You know, that's what the mind says. I don't think I can handle this shot. I haven't figured it out yet. What is there to figure out? See flag, hit the flag. I'll figure anything. Nothing to figure out, really. Just go up there and crush it. What do you think? We're thinking about all these things I need to do right. I need to do this. Okay, now let me see. You're thinking of everything. Doesn't work. Messes you up. So I'll give this a try. I realize I need a new philosophy, you know, in life and with golf. A new philosophy. That's it. So I'll give it a try. People say, well, you're not a good golfer. Well, you know, yeah, well, what'd you score? Wow, really? Well, that's a good score. But, you know, you're not really that good of a golfer. Well, okay. I mean, you want to be a good golfer or do you want to be a good scorer? Because usually those people who try to be these, you know, real good golfer, they don't score. They can't score. Hardly anybody can score. There's just few people that, you know, they figured it out somehow. There's some people are the naturals, you know, and what can you say about that? They have a knack, but most people have, you know, they have trouble with it, unless they figure it out. Like, hey, let's just keep it simple here. you see some of these pros like trick shot artists, you know, like Chichi Rodriguez and Lee Trevino and those kind of, they get hit, you know, well, the wind, they're going to hit a low bender, you know, draw a little, fade it into the wind, ride the wind. You know, there's all these wind players, they do all these fancy stuff, and we're watching, oh, yeah, that'd be cool if I could hit that shot, people might think I'm really good. This is how people think. You know, so that spiritually we think the same way. Oh, somebody's in this, you know, yoga posture. Oh, boy, if I could do this and sit there quietly, you know, people might think that I'm some kind of great meditator, yogi or something. It's just a complete waste of time. Use the trick shots when you're fooling around, you know, and then don't, you know, wow, just went about the whole thing backwards. What a regret, you know, seeing this now. It's just the youth, you know, we're so stupid, we want to prove ourselves. And we end up doing more than we need to do. You know, when you're feeling defensively, like you need to prove yourself, you end up messing up because you're trying to impress someone, and then you overthink, overdo, and you feel more nervous, and that makes you feel more insecure, and then you overdo more, and you know it compounds itself. People don't understand that abidance is the goal. They think they're supposed to do some of these pyrotechnics or something. And look at Ron Maharshi, he said he's not doing anything. Where's his accomplishments? I remember I used to look at it that way. Abidance is the goal. This is it. Experiencing absolute freedom from any outcomes, any accomplishments, outcomes. No, there are no outcomes at all. We're perfectly free. Experiencing that. Abiding in that. That's all there is to it. You know, and we think, they're supposed to be doing a bunch of miraculous stuff. The doing, producing outcomes. Healing this person, healing that person. You know, that's part of the problem with Christianity. Is they look at it spiritual. The goal is like we become supermen, superwomen, super spirit, doing all this miraculous stuff and raising people from the dead and, you know, just... No, that's not it. The raising from the dead is to abide. Abidance is the raising from the dead. No longer dead. When we believe in outcomes, we believe in our own death. We believe in death. We think if we don't have that outcome, we'll die. And we're so afraid of not having any outcomes, we end up producing the outcome of death to hold on to outcomes. And this seems to protect us. We think, well, you know, it's better than having no outcome at all. We look at having no outcomes at all as if we're annihilation. So we say, well, we're going to die, but it's going to be an outcome. It's just something like that. we feel without the outcome, we'll be dead. So we create the fear of our own annihilation, really. And then to try and manage that, we, you know, dreamed up death, and which actually emphasizes outcomes, right? It's an outcome to a life. We say, I had a life of outcomes, and this is the this cements, concretizes outcomes and concretization. So yeah, we look at Ramana Maharshi and in our Western tradition and say, well, what's he doing? What's he doing sitting there? He needs to be doing something. What kind of outcomes? I don't see him getting any outcomes. He should be building hospitals, treating people, going all over the place and, you know, doing stuff. We're offended. Our sensibilities are offended. You know, we think, you know, this isn't right. There's some laziness here or something. Not true. Not true. Ramana said that, you know, he did way more by just sitting still than anyone could possibly do by running around. Way more by not saying anything than anyone could say do by saying stuff. He says, by saying nothing, I'm saying everything. By doing nothing, I'm doing everything. That's one way to look at it. Because in absolute freedom, you are doing everything, so to speak. You are everything. You're all doing and all not doing. And so he's pointing out, you know, he was giving a very strong pointer to this. So it seems like only later in life are you able to see this, because of youth feels like it needs to prove itself. This is a problem. But if there were more enlightened beings in the world, youth would not feel so strongly it had to prove itself. We live in a terrible society now where youths are brought up just thinking they have to prove themselves every last second to, you know, the parents, their teachers, their employers, everybody prove, drives them nuts. That's why they're all on drugs. Suffering so much stress and anxiety. Whereas if someone like, more, if there was a lot of those like Ramana Maharshi, the young people and the parents could accept this and the young people would say, hey, doing outcomes, it's not important. In fact, they don't really exist at all. And I can, you know, I can still be pragmatically function here, but I don't need to be obsessed with trying to prove myself. So then it enables them to then simplify and just start practicing simply, because they're not trying to show some of, well, I can do some advanced stuff, really advanced, really this fancy stuff. I'll throw a bunch of bells and whistles in there. No, they say, no, I don't need to throw any bells and whistles in there. Let me just do this simple thing. Sri Nisargadatta Maharaj just said, let me just focus on the feeling of I am. And that's it. He never did any other practice. His teacher said, just do this. He did it. He was enlightened. This is a great example. He didn't mess around with any other practice or anything. No postures, no nothing. He just tried to keep his mind on the feeling of I am. And that's the sum total of a spiritual practice. And it, like, what was it, 4 years? Boom. Abidance. What's more important, that you know all every single path, the spiritual path, like Anandamayama, or you know just the simple way to succeed? What's more important? It's more important, the simple way to succeed. It's more important, actually, for us. I mean, for the functioning of an avatar, they function as they function. But she always said, just keep me out of this. Don't use me as an example, actually. So it's more important for us to simply know one practice that works for us. and use that as an example to others. That's what really helps. It's these teachers who do know just one practice that are the most helpful, but they reaffirm for us, you don't have to be this spiritual virtuoso, like, you know, oh, I do every style possible. It's like a musician, well, I can do every style possible, but, you know, it's better to do one style and be, you know, total virtuoso at it. Because that drives home the point of virtuosity. The point is not doing different styles. The point is to be a virtuoso. The point is to be in abidance. That's the goal. That is the virtuosity. But to pursue all sorts of, you know, different ways and try to be like that and not reach the goal is folly. It's trying to prove ourselves or feeling insecure. It's like on a golf course, you feel this golf course is going to beat me up so bad, but if I can let me like, you know, start the ball out over the lake and fade it back into the fairway, if I could just do that, maybe the plane, you know, people will look at me and say, ah, he's got a game. All the rest of the struggle is really just an aberration, you know, because we know we're going to like struggle like crazy, but if we hit this one, like, you know, trick shot or kind of shows that like, wow, we really thought that one through and pulled it off, then people say, oh yeah, yeah, he knows how to play, you know, he's just having a bad day or just struggling. we hope for that kind of thing. And so we spend our time on some trick shot or you know, trying to do that instead of just doing the basics right. And then we wouldn't struggle. And people think they have to do like play golf in a beautiful way too. Right? They got to hit these majestic shots, a high shot. You know, oh, that's such a, okay, you've thought that one. If you're just playing, you know, just boom, boom, with the flag, knocking, you know, chip it in, chip, you know, knock it in. Yeah, they look at scorecard, par, 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 birdie, birdie, par, par, par. You know, they go, ah, you know, I didn't see anything. Just, oh, really? You got all pars? Oh, really? I didn't even notice that, you know. Just, yeah, I was looking at somebody else. You see that shot that he just hit there? That was a really beautiful shot. And it wasn't in the bunker, but it looked real good in the air. You know, well, they took a double bogey, but you know, blasted out of the sand nicely, just went a little too far. And, well, they missed the putt coming back, and double bogey. And, yeah, but it was beautiful golf, you know, the way they played the hole. Just, you know, some... And another guy, you know, just boom, boom, chip in, and it's not pretty. It doesn't, you know, it's not aesthetically stunning or anything. But yeah, just, oh yeah, just got another par, you know, ho hum, boring par. So, you know, the philosophy we're working on is just to get that boring par. Yeah, oh, yeah, par, no problem, got it. Yeah, easy. And we just want that abidance, that boring abidance. And of course, there'll be all sorts of people running around spiritualizing their lives and their houses in the world. And, you know, a few people here and there, they're in abidance, you know. A few of us. Which is what really helps the world. Ramana Maharshi said, the greatest good you can do for this world by far is your own abidance, your own realization, self-realization. Nothing comes close. This is the greatest good you can do. Boring par. Oh yeah, I've got this boring par. Just doing a few little exercises here, and that's it. Very simple. Could we call this path boring yoga? Par yoga. Grip it and rip it yoga. Actually, oh, well, they say, well, they just don't understand the subtleties. Oh, this is grip it and rip it yoga. Come on. We're delving into all the subtleties of it. We've come up with millions of subtleties and all the extrapolations and outcomes of these subtleties, and we're greatly fixated on writing books about all these subtleties. Who are those heathen over there doing grip it and rip it yoga? Oh, they're abiding in. They're in abidance. Ah. But it makes them think. It makes them think, right? Think, how come I'm not in abidance? You know, this. I'll get there someday. You know, it'll be, well, if they keep overthinking it, they won't. It's kind of shocking when you realize that it, you know, your mistakes, and you realize if you hadn't realized your mistakes, you would have kept doing them your whole life. This is, you know, it's this is a big wow. I just, wow. Just like in golf, I realized, hey, if I hadn't realized my mistakes, my wrong philosophy there, I would have continued with the wrong philosophy my whole life. Better late than never. And maybe we reach abidance and we think, oh, that was easy, but I want to try some more difficult way to get there. So I'll drop it for now. There must be some more difficult way, more sophisticated way. It's more difficult. I mean, that was too easy. Yeah, that's not golf. You know, that's not spiritual path. It's too easy. What we're really saying is, well, I want to make it feel like an outcome. I want it to be like an outcome. How come I know where's the outcome? You know. So this brings us back to our practice now that we have, which helps, you know, helps us pass this stumbling block. Is when we get abidance, we'll say, okay, that's great, but where's the outcome? It doesn't feel like there's any outcome. This is wonderful, but can't I do it in a way that it feels like an outcome? And then. You lose it. So we'll say, yeah, well, I neither have an outcome, nor do I not have an outcome. I neither have an outcome, nor do I not have an outcome. So we'll say, I neither played golf, nor did I not play golf. I'm neither playing golf, nor am I not playing golf. I'm going to try that. I'm neither playing golf today. I'm neither playing golf, nor am I not playing golf. I'm neither on a golf course, nor am I not on a golf course. I'm neither hitting shots, nor am I not hitting shots. And just try that. Try to stay in a Biden's thing where it's okay to not be troubled in such a way it doesn't even feel like outcomes. It's just they say this is so simple. I mean, I can do this all day, you know. So I really can't think of it as an outcome, really. So we want outcomes in life. So, you know, it's amazing. A person like will want like a hole in one, you know, more than they want that more than anything. And they can play terrible for 30 years, but if they get a hole in one, oh, I finally got an outcome, you know. So they want outcomes. We want outcomes, outcomes, and when we slip into abidance, it's like that doesn't feel like an outcome. That's too easy. Outcomes can't be that easy. See, we can't even define it as an outcome. It's so easy. We want something to be difficult. Oh, I made a hole in one. Oh, there's an outcome. Don't do that once in a lifetime, you know. And won't do it again, but at least I got an outcome. That makes it an outcome because it's rare. You know, I had a rare outcome. Whereas abundance, you're continually there. And you're like, well, if you're just that way all the time, how can you say it's rare? How can you say it's a rare outcome or something? So people, we tend to go for these peak experiences. Oh yeah, I had this peak experience. I had this rare outcome. It really validates the self and validates my life. I had a life. You know, if I look up all the outcomes, all the doings that I did, you know, I can look back and this and this and this and this. Whereas abidance, you know, is just like, there's no doing, there's no outcomes, there's no, it's just right now. Well, how can I say I had a life, right? So these are the issues that you know, dog us. And we need a philosophy, that we really have a philosophy here now that we're, you know, seeing more and more clearly. It's simple, you know, grip it and rip it yoga. Knock the flag down yoga. But grip it and rip it yoga is maybe a good way to put it. Don't think, overthink the situation. You know, how far are you out? 140, we'll, you know, or 130, we'll get the 8-iron. And, you know, hit the flag. That's it. And it's a funny thing because people think that they can't hit the flag. So they say, well, okay, I can't really shoot at the pin because that's the pros don't shoot at the pin usually. They try to, you know, finesse it or something and spin it, you know, draw it in and then spin it and all this kind of nonsense. And there's something about, well, if I go at the flag, it's not supposed to do that. So then they don't have a goal. Crazy stuff. Or they think, well, I'm not good enough to go at the pin. You know, I can't shoot at the flag. I mean, there's just like this taboo against it. I want to try and, you know, get it somewhere on the green and, you know, but get it close, but I mean, right at it, directly, straight on, right at it. And I've noticed like my shots recently have been dead on the pin. Never have I had that happen before. I just like, you know, shot after shot after shot after shot is going straight at it. Now it might be a little short or a little long, but as far as alignment goes, it's just dead straight at the pin. And never done that before. Because it's a mental thing. It's a mental thing. We think we're not supposed to do that. Yeah, the pros, they aim away from the pin. You know, they know, stay out of the danger, they aim away from the pin. And can try to draw it in. They say, well, going for the pin shows a lack of imagination. Yeah, that's like, faith, abiding shows a lack of imagination. Of course, we're not imagining outcomes anymore. We're not imagining concretization anymore. We want a lack of imagination. That's the whole goal. I mean, it's imagination that is our trouble. Do we really want to be a golfer, or do we want to say, no, I've conquered golf, absolutely destroyed the golf course? That didn't, can't do anything to me, can't even touch me. Isn't that what we want? Or do you want to be this, well, I'm a golfer and I gotta respect the course. And, today the course had its way with me. And, sometimes, you get the bear, sometimes the bear gets you, and really struggled out there today and, took a beating and really respect the course. It was really difficult today and just couldn't get anything going out there. And, but yeah, I fought the good fight, I'm a good golfer. Really? Really? Is that what we really want? Or we want to say, what course? I didn't see any course out there. I was just having some fun, taking a walk in the park, smacking some balls around. I didn't see any golf course out there, really. What world? I don't see any world. World? There's no world. There's no life. There's no a life in the world. There's no world. There's no life. There's no outcomes. There's no valuing. There's no accumulation of outcomes. There's no concretization. There's none of that. Or do we want to say, oh, I struggled so much through my life. I fought all these battles. I won a few, but lost more my share. There's all these war stories we want to talk about. Oh my gosh, yeah, I had a close call there. It was terrible there, and tragedy here. Yeah, but what a fulfilling life. I had led a full life. I want someone to eulogize me. I got to writing my resume so that someone can eulogize me about all the stuff I went through. Anyway, so yeah, well, at least I had a life. I don't want a life. Who wants a life? That's the craziest thing ever. Who wants a life? Are you kidding me? We are eternal life. We are eternal life. We don't need a life. I'm blessing the golf course by even showing up on the golf course. So for me, there's no golf course. There's no golf course like that. There's no golf course. It's just a, I'm just blessing everything. It's just a blessing that's happening. It's just a blessing. That's all. And of course, the golf course architects, they want to frustrate you. They want to make you think, And if you don't think, well, they frustrated their ambition. Their ambition in life was to make every golfer plays this course think and struggle and have difficulty and be challenged and stuff. And then you breeze through it like, what course? Is there a course here somewhere? Did they miss something? Just had a nice walk in the park. The architect is like, well, then if the architect wants a challenge, let them play the course, and think that way. Just because somebody thinks that they've have a life doesn't mean you have to have a life. So just because a bunch of spirits want to have a life, it doesn't mean that other spirits have to have a life. Just because some spirits want to imagine that they have a life in a world doesn't mean we have to imagine that we have a life in a world. Late, getting late here. You need to wrap it up. Or not. Why is this cord? Let's catch in the cord. Okay, there we go. Yeah, abide in. So we think it's too simple. It's too simple. I mean, like, oh, that was simple. I could do that all. I could do this all day. Well, just sit with this card right now. I could do this all day. I could do this. I could do this all forever. You know, this is so easy. I could just keep doing this. Yeah. So, well, you know, that. Too easy, we think. Well, in terms of outcome, we think it's easy because there is no outcome. But the outcomes we chase aren't outcomes either, actually. And we just keep chasing after them. You know, trying to get an outcome now to justify the outcome we thought we got before, which we don't feel is quite an outcome, and it just goes on and on and on, like chasing our tail. We're just going around in circles chasing our tail. Like cats or dogs, young cats or dogs, they say, I want to do something, I want to do something, I want to go something. Oh, let me chase my tail. You know, they go swirling around in circles till they get dizzy. People want to say, well, I had a spiritual life. I had a very spiritual life. That's the booby prize. Having a spiritual life is the total booby prize. Again, what is this thing catching on? Okay. I think that's... I figured out that something was catching on it. Spiritual life. That's the booby prize. That's what you don't want. You want abidance. You want a spiritual life. You want abidance. That's not a spiritual life. That is eternal life. We don't want a life, a spiritual life. That's the biggest waste of time ever. Say we don't say, oh, I had a spiritual life. I wore the right yoga attire, and then the right shawls and the right beaded, you know, handbag, you know, shoulder bag, and I was like, had the right yoga pants and the right sandals and the beads and the hairstyle, and I was able to, you know, I look spiritual. I read the right books. I smiled, kind of. Looked like I, you know, was like maybe in bliss occasionally, and people thought maybe I'm spiritual, and so yeah, I had a real good spiritual life, you know. and I avoided abidance because then people might not think I'm so spiritual, and often, you know, yeah. That's how it goes here. I mean, this isn't it. This is not it. Whew, getting chilly now. The chill has started here now. It's because it rained today and the air is moist. Yeah, this is really changing weather patterns. No question about it. The weather pattern this year has been very different than the drought years. So it's very unlikely to be a drought year. You never know, but it's unlikely. We keep getting these little edges of storms that keep hitting us and dropping a little bit of moisture, and just everything is different. Lots of clouds moving around now, which is great. I mean, clouds are nice to see clouds again. We're not used to it. So, okay. Spiritual life. Don't have a spiritual life. That's going to be the big loser. That's the big loser. Now, you know you're a big loser, but you want other people to think, well, you were a winner. As you when you pass on, die, and you think, I hope people thought that I was a winner. I'm spiritual. I hope they thought that way. I tried to, I tried to look the part and play the part, and maybe they'll think I am. And you're within, wait a minute, but I don't want to go back there, but I'm going back there. Ah, gosh, that's terrible. I'm a loser. But I don't want people to know what a loser I am, so I gotta appear to be spiritual so they won't think I'm such a loser. Look, we're all trying to come up with outcomes is we're all total losers because we've all completely failed at that. So we're all total failures, except at eternal life, which we're perfect at that. And that's, of course, all there is. So, game, set, and match. We're done. And we will see how it goes from here. Very great. That's it.